Hi, hope you have enjoyed the two sessions on the ethical issues involved in scientific research. This is the last session in this series. Here, I'll be talking about the ethical issues involved when human beings are subjects of research. Lot of care has to be taken when we involve human beings as our subjects in the research.
Along with this, we will be discussing about the ethics of research with animals. Similarly, reasons for misconduct in scientific research, role of whistleblowers, and controlling of misconduct in research are the other topics that we discuss in this session. Let us start with ethics of research involving human subjects. The ethics involved in scientific research with human subjects is a point at which the good of the individual and the good of the society conflict with each other. The policies and procedures that protect the rights and welfare of human subjects can hinder scientific research that benefits society. Hence, research with human subjects remains a controversial topic. Trust in research. Trust has an important role in research where human subjects are involved. Human subjects of a research should trust the investigators and feel confident that they will undertake the research professionally, competently, and ethically. If they don't trust the investigators, the human subjects may not participate in the project or they may not cooperate well wholeheartedly. The investigators also should trust the human subjects and explain to them the details of the project. The trustworthiness of the institutes and the organizations involved in research is a major factor influencing the human subjects. More importantly, the investigators involved in a research should trust each other and behave professionally, competently, and ethically. From these, it can be seen that trust forms a foundation for the ethics of research with human subjects. There were several policy declarations regarding this, and the Bellman Report of 1979 remains a milestone declaration. It was issued for the protection of human subjects of biomedical and behavioral research. As per this report, the main principles of ethical research involving human subjects has three facets. They are respect for persons, beneficence, and justice. Let us discuss the first option, respect for human subjects. Respecting the privacy, emotions, and values of human subjects who are part of the research are inevitable for its success. By respecting the human subjects, trust develops between the researcher and the subject. This helps in the smooth conduct and success of a research project. Now let us know what is informed consent. Informed consent is critical in developing trust between the investigator and the human subjects. This helps the subjects in establishing a trust that the investigator will treat them with respect and do no harm to them. In the process of getting consent, the researcher will explain the objectives of the research, methods followed, and how the subjects will be protected from harm. We can consider the process as a contract between the investigator and the subject. Usually, consent is a written and signed agreement, but the process involves much more than that. As the written consent form consists of jargons and legal terms, investigators read it out for the subjects for understanding it well. This builds up more trust in them. Five conditions are necessary for consent to be valid. They are competence, information, voluntary decision, comprehension, and authorization. Let us see what is competence. It is the legal capacity of a person to make a decision. As such, adults are presumed to be competent unless otherwise declared by a court of law. Competence is also defined as the capacity to make a responsible choice. A mentally ill adult is legally capable, but he is not in a position to make an autonomous decision. Hence, he lacks competence. Let us see what is information. The person making consent should have enough information about the project to make an informed decision. Hence, the investigators have the responsibility of disclosing the details of the project. Now, let us see what is voluntary decision. The person making a choice should do it on his own, knowing everything about the research. No undue influence or coercion should be there on him while making the decision. Coercion involves the use of force, intimidation, or threats to make someone comply with a demand or request. Now let us see what is comprehension. The person making the decision to give consent must be able to comprehend or understand the information. The documents about research naturally will contain jargons and technical words with which the subjects may believe that the research is an attempt to provide treatment than an attempt to gain knowledge. Finally, let us see what is authorization. The person providing the consent must agree by communicating his agreement verbally or signing a document or by making some other sign of authorization. The subjects also should have the right to withdraw from the research participation. Various declarations have pronounced this right with clarity. They can discontinue the participation at any time without penalty or loss of benefits to which the subject is otherwise entitled. The third aspect explained under Bellman's report is beneficence. Beneficence in this context refers to maximization of benefits of the research and minimization of risks. A benefit is something we regard as a valuable good, health, food, clothing, shelter, self-esteem, happiness, virtue, knowledge, wealth, or freedom. We may value a benefit for its own sake. Benefits can be for individuals, communities, or society. Research benefits of the society as a whole by promoting the growth of human knowledge, which in turn will help in the development of medical treatments and better public health practices and interventions. Investigators frequently collect data. This is useful for the subjects also. If it is made available to the subjects of the research, it will be beneficial for them. If the investigator wants to retain a long-term rapport with the subject, it is appropriate to have full disclosure of the data about him. Disclosing individual data may be appropriate when it will not significantly add to the cost of the study. Further, investigators should inform research subjects about their plans to provide the data. This promotes trust and respects autonomy. The investigators also should inform the subjects about the availability of counseling, treatment, referrals, and dealing with the results.
The final aspect that was discussed under Bellman report is about justice. In this context, justice means the fair distribution of benefits and burdens of the research. Make the benefits of the research beneficial for all those who have participated in the research equally and also for the good of the society. You have seen the ethical issues related to the research involving human beings. Now we will learn the ethical issues involved in making use of animals in the research. This is also a hot topic of discussion in academic parlance.
Research studies with the help of animals are very common, especially in the field of drugs and medical research. For finding treatment to different diseases in human beings, various tests are initially conducted on animals, especially rats. Animal research has contributed to a large extent in scientific advances in the past and continues to aid our understanding of various diseases. Since Aristotle and Hippocrates' times in an ancient Greece, the use of animals goes hand in hand with the development of medicine. The discovery of anesthetics and Darwin's Origin of Species, defending the biological similarities between man and animal, gave a boost to the animal experimentation. Increased concern over the welfare of animals led to legislation in many countries and also the establishment of animal ethics committees. However, the use of animals for research has always been a topic of serious debate. Do we need to use animals for medical research is still a question raised from time to time. There are different views on this issue. Those in favor of using animals in research argue that animals are no way equal to human beings. Therefore, use of animals in scientific research and the data derived from them is justifiable. They argue the following: it causes sufferings to animals, the benefits to human beings are not proven, any benefits such derived from animal testing could be produced in other ways also. The supporters of animal research argue that the experiments on animals will produce such great benefits for humanity that it is morally acceptable to harm few animals. While those who oppose say that the sufferings to animals and the number of animals used for experiments is so high that the benefits to humanity do not provide moral justification. Scientists, especially the biomedical researchers, use millions of animals every year for their research. One of the important issues in the experiments in scientific research is to consider ethics in animal experimentation. When the use of an animal is essential for medical research, we can consider some guidelines. Help can be taken from the American Association of Psychologists Guidelines for Ethical Conduct in Care and Use of Animals. This will help the researchers in designing their studies based on animals. Ethical considerations when animals are involved in research studies are essential to prevent and minimize the sufferings caused to animals. In 2008, the European Union put forward a proposal to revise the directive for the protection of animals used in scientific experiments in line with the 3R principles: reduction, refinement, replacement. Under reduction, there are 4 items. They are: you can reduce the number of animals used in the experiments by improving experimental techniques, improving techniques for data analysis, and sharing of information with other researchers. This will minimize the chances of repeating the experiments. Under refinement, the experiments or the way animals are cared for so as to reduce their sufferings by using less invasive techniques, better medical care, and better living conditions. Replacement is the last method, where experiments on animals with alternative techniques such as experimenting on cell culture instead of whole animals, using computer models, studying human volunteers, using epidemiological studies, etc. The 2008 proposal also introduces a ban on the use of great apes, chimpanzees, baboons, gorillas, orangutans in scientific procedures, other than exceptional circumstances. But there is no proposal to phase out the use of other non-human primates shortly. The general practice is that before starting any such study, the research proposal is reviewed by the Animal Ethics Committee. Before using animals, the researcher must clarify their scientific purpose. There is a need to justify why a hypothesis needs to be tested using animals has to be considered. If the use of animals is inevitable, the number of them used should be minimum. All personnel who work with the animals should be sufficiently trained in both the experimental procedures and in handling the animals ethically. Skilled people should administer surgery and anesthesia to the animals in the study. The study should be designed in such a way that minimum harm is caused to the animals involved. Their pain and discomfort should be minimal. If required, anesthesia should be used. Repeated surgical procedures on the same animal should be avoided.
Care should be taken that animals are housed in appropriate facilities. Researchers are encouraged to consider enriching the environments of all their laboratory animals.
Now, let us know why these types of misconduct is happening in scientific research. There are various reasons for this. They may vary from person to person and from place to place. But we will look into these reasons in general.
It is essential to report and investigate scientific misconduct and non-compliance to research ethics. As we all know, prevention is better than cure. It would be good if we can avoid such instances. This can prevent the damage to many aspects, including the career of the researchers and the future of the institutions involved. If we need to prevent scientific misconduct, we should also know the causes. Some of them are listed below. Pressure to produce results or publish. Poor supervision of subordinates. Poor communication. Lack of awareness or understanding of research rules. Lack of education or mentoring in research ethics and compliance. Conflicts between different roles in research. Ethical versus scientific is an example. Conflicts of interest. Cultural differences concerning ethical standards. Personal conflicts among researchers and staff. Poor leadership.
As human beings, we will not allow a discrepancy to happen in front of us. We react to those situations. One who reacts to such situation is called as a whistleblower. Let us see our responsibilities as a whistleblower when we work in a scientific community.
Whistleblowers are those individuals, often a co-worker of the violator, who calls attention to the violation either before the authorities or in public. In most cases, they face more repercussions than the violator. If the accusations are baseless, the whistleblower gets fired. Hence, being whistleblower is always a risk. Researchers being human beings who tend to be competitive, chances of breach of ethics are many. Hence, we have to improve our ability to catch instances of such misconducts by promoting whistleblowers. However, knowing what is scientific misconduct is the best way to avoid it.
Scientific misconduct could be controlled to a great extent. What all we can do for that? This is the content of the next portion in this video.
Let us see what are the measures with which we can control the misconduct in research. First is policy development. Institutions should develop policies related to research integrity issues. The policies should define expected standards of behavior and establish procedures for reporting, investigating, and adjudicating misconduct, non-compliance, and other significant problems in research. Education. Institutions should educate investigators, research staff, students, trainees, and administrators about misconduct, complaints, data management, conflicts of interest, etc. Researchers who work with human subjects should have special instruction in the relevant regulations, policies, and guidelines. Mentoring. Investigators mentor their students and trainees in research ethics. Leadership. Institutional leaders should affirm their commitment to research ethics and compliance through their words and deeds. They should stress the importance of following ethical and legal standards for the conduct of research in their communications with investigators, students, trainees, staff, and administrators. Auditing. Institutions should regularly audit research records, including data, case reports, and informed consent documents. Auditing can discourage misconduct and non-compliance and catch problems at the very early stages itself before they become worse. And finally, it is administrative support. Institutions should provide adequate administrative support for research ethics and compliance activities.
Hope you have enjoyed all the three sessions. More than anything, you have come to know that all is not well in scientific research and there are remedies for such malpractices. This very wisdom that you have acquired through these sessions would help you a lot in maintaining decency and good conduct as a researcher. Please try to get the books listed in the bibliographies and get more ideas on these aspects. I thank you for listening.